So you just talked to his child. It's about 10 o'clock now. You probably took a while talking to Ilsar. Do you want to write his name down by some chance?
Yeah.
I-L-S-O-A-R-I. Gandis. G-A-N-D-E-T-H-U-S.
Teacher. The kid is
Errol.
Okay. And then Grawl.
A-A-L.
Yeah. Perfection for all that.
I'm just trying to keep all these people that I'm trying to keep in my life.
Sure. Well, don't you have the page of allies right here?
Oh, yeah, you're right. I
see?
Do.
There you go, buddy. Okay, so, like I said, it's late, but you, like I said, you see that kid was sleeping. Is there anything you want to do for the night? You just want to get out for the next day? And you let me know what you're wanting to do. Because really, you said you're going to be here 3 days, so this is your first day, you're only going on the third.
Yeah.
You've got a whole day ahead of you of doing nothing.
Yeah.
You could even ship out if you wanted to. I mean, you paid her.
Making a good impression is kind of what I want to do.
Well,
the teacher, I wanted to put it in the kid.
Well, I'd say you've accomplished that.
I kind of want to talk to the sheriff or the mayor tomorrow to maybe not leave such a bad mark when it's associated with my
town,
city.
For report.
Yeah. Maybe I can go talk to them, see if I can help out. And I was going to kind of bring up the grave robbing thing that I came across. Maybe I offer some help with that to see if there's anything I could help with.
All right. Okay. Are you going to go to the mayor or the sheriff?
Mayor, because she seemed a little more pleased talking to me.
Kendra Debrin.
Yes.
Here's a little picture, by the way. Ba-bow.
Oh, yeah.
So you go to their office, you ask a couple people around town. People's kind of gathered who you are now. You know, your importance. But everybody can't help but look strange.
Yeah.
I mean, a half-orc, not so much a big difference. It's that scar.
Yeah. I don't carry the clout that I do in my town, nor they're used to me.
Well, it's your look and then the face.
Yeah.
It doesn't really, you know, fit. So you meet with Kendra Devrin. You're escorted right into her office. She's like, Lord Tornhart, how can I help you?
I'll tell her
that... Is everything all right? I mean,
oh, everything's great. I actually... I'll tell her that actually, whenever I went to speak with the teacher over there, I may have found somebody to take home with me.
Adopting a kid?
I'll say I'm as surprised as you are, to tell you the truth.
She's actually taken aback. She's like, gathers us up. Can I be frank with you?
Sure. I would actually appreciate that.
Do you think it's wise to take a small child to Riddleport?
I can offer...
No, I'm not doubting who you are and whatnot, but the town has a reputation. And I understand by, since your takeover, that things have gotten a little better. There's not so much bloodshed on the street. There's control. She's like, but I mean... Let's face it, your town is full of murderers, thieves, prostitutes, and drugs.
That's very true.
And then here you are before me, and you're going to adopt a child, and you're going to take it to your town. And I'm sorry, but that just kind of raises some red flags. And I can't stop you, I can't. For the safety of an innocent child, I mean, do you understand that? An innocent child...
I will guarantee you that everything that I have at my disposal will keep that child safe. And I'm not lying.
Yeah, I know
what I'm saying.
I know you're not. But she's going to look at you skeptically because, I mean, hey, let's take this 12-year-old brown-headed green-eyed kid to Rudelport. Disney World for all types of the underworld.
Yeah. He'll have a hell of a time. But you can take me at my word on that.
Like she said, there's nothing she can do. It's just that she wants to voice her concern over a child being taken there. And it's understandable because, man, there's not only is it prostitution, there's no telling what type of sex rings that at one time there were. I mean,
there was. I keep a very strict enforced town.
Obviously.
And that kind of bleeds over to what I want to speak with you about now, honestly.
All right.
That's a good transition. As I was walking your town, taking in the sights, I noticed the guard in the grave digger, looking at a grave that they said they thought had maybe been robbed. And as I questioned them, I just noticed a couple things. And as I was walking away, they actually said that this had been happening just a little bit. And that bothers me. A town needs to be
protected.
Town needs to be protected. A town needs to know the rules. If something's going, is there something I can help with while I'm here? I have a couple of days.
Yeah, she like I'm doing now because I'm just kind of long hair. She kind of does this. She's like, that's the least of our problems.
Okay.
As you can tell, we're just kind of out here in the wild.
Yeah.
Just don't get me wrong, Sandpoint's been here for a long time.
Yeah.
And
well, your borders can be,
yeah.
You know, your cities can be contained, but your borders can be wild.
That's right. And, you know, the town has not been here the longest. It's not well established, but it's grown. And seeing that we're still here through all the goblin tribes around here says something. And, the grave robbing is the least of our problems. Here the last 4 or 5 months, just one or two graves have been dug open. Contents gone.
Okay.
She's like,
entirely gone? Bodies and everything?
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's nobody in particular.
No one of importance.
No one of importance. You know, just bodies.
Wealthy families and poor families alike?
Yes.
Okay. So that leads me to believe they're not after just monetary things.
No. And the only thing any of the bodies have in common is they're old.
Okay.
They've been there for years.
Okay.
But we don't have any corpses running around attacking anybody. We don't have any of that.
Yeah.
So that's why that's kind of on the back burner. If we could figure out why, sure.
Okay.
But, I mean, you know, the least of the towns.
Well, tell me. Well, I'm here. I've been known to crush threats, things like that.
You like what you crushed the town, took it over. She kind of laughs.
They were,
she's
they
realized,
were a threat.
She realizes she can be open with you. She's like, well.
What is there anything I could aid you with? Your men.
She's like, well, here we go. Our biggest concern is the locals are now calling the blood fog.
The blood fog. Interested in this?
She's like, some have outran it, lived to tell about it. As much as I hate the term, those who have been caught up on it and made their way back to town, all two of them that have not died, locals call them the crazed. We've taken them to Hape Sanitarium about a mile away, and all they can talk about is this thick red fog and the beings within it that came for them.
The beings within it?
That came for them. She's like, two of our own townspeople. Let me get to them here. The sanitarium. if you decide to go talk to these people, are I got them here somewhere. Helen Sade and Gerald, just the guy they call Gerald. He's an old beggar. Both have survived the fog, but have gone crazed. It's to the point where we have had to lock them up in Hayes Sanitarium. And if it tells you anything, Mr. Tornhart, we rarely have to use a sanitarium. Shall I continue, or are you spooked enough?
I'm very interested in that.
She's like, well, she's like, that is a huge risk. But, and you know, if you fixed it, that's fine. She's like, but other than that, besides the goblin tribes that always attack people traveling here, if anything, please stay away from the north.
What's in the north?
The goblin tribes.
Okay.
They tend to not only war with travelers, but war with each other. And there's a... they can be pretty vicious. As in, they are known to leave bodies with their hands and feet missing on the road.
Okay.
They are called... that is, I would say, probably one of the most vicious tribe, the Chop Chop Tribe, as they call themselves. Chop Chop Tribe. There has been some giants spotted in the hillside wandering around looking for us, and the locals have clashed with these brutes. But that is a concern of all the farmers. Just northeast of here is our farming community. And though we have small 2-3-man patrols, people do worry about their safety out there. She's like, so, like I said, grave robbing,
yeah,
least of our concerns.
I understand now. I thought maybe that was a big deal, but compared to these three things.
No, nothing. The goblin tribes are something that's always going to be a deal. It's something we've dealt with since this place was founded.
Right, and unless you just kill them all, they're like roaches, they'll keep
coming
back.
But they've, it's almost become to a point where they're territorial. But like I said, we tried to keep people off the road going between those tribes. She's like, but like I said, this blood fog is a thing that we're worried about because we don't know when it comes. It's only at night. And we do have people that tend to our farms out there. So, I mean, if you want to help, pick and choose.
Man, I would like to try to speak with... Helen and Gerald, maybe.
So you want to go to the sanatorium?
To Habes.
To Habes Sanatorium, all right. She'll write you out a note. She's like, Habe usually doesn't let anybody in the sanatorium without a note from me or Sheriff Bellor. So even after today, which you did say you would be gone by tomorrow, she's like, please do not go to Habes without any type of notification from us.
Okay.
It would be well appreciated.
Okay.
So you're going to head to the sanatorium.
Yeah.
It's about a mile walk, I should say, out that way. Did you bring your horse?
Yep.
Should know. Okay. Now, my question is about this. You will have to go around some mountains, too, around Ashen Moor. Let me look around and see if there's anything she can tell you about this Ashen Moor that you should worry about. No. She does tell you, don't be surprised if you do run into the occasional small group of goblins foraging.
Okay.
She's like, if anything, I ask you, please do not start any fights with these. She's like, because it can only make things worse
here.
Oh, yeah,
it can turn into a war.
Yes. And that is the last thing we want. But she writes you a note to go to the sanatorium, and she's like, please give Habe my thanks for taking care of Helen and Gerald. And she's like, I do warn you that Habe is a very odd person, so please be kind to him. He's his wife died years ago when they were young, and tragically, and he's just never seemed to get over it. He really loses himself in the sanatorium trying to cure people of illnesses. But like we said, we don't hardly send anybody up there. He does get people occasionally from like Magnemar, but don't expect to find anybody else there.
Okay.
So head to Hague Sanatorium?
Yeah.
Okay, so do you drop
no.
bones in town?
No.
That's very smart.
No.
So you're gonna get so far outside of town?
I'll walk outside of town and then I'll know that.
Alright. The squat stone building, we're just going to move on up to the sanatorium.
Sure.
It serves as a sanatorium. It has three floors under a stout stone flagged roof and is built in the lee of limestone escarpment known as Asherism, which I told you, you know, don't fight. She said don't fight any goblins while you're out here. So think creepy gothic sanatorium and you're looking at one.
Cool.
It's got a fence.
Yeah.
Got a barred fence. It's not wood. Like, you could stick your arm through it, but you couldn't squeeze through it. And it does, and it is loaded with spikes around the top to keep people out and in. And there is a large metal gate in the front of it.
Any guard or anything posted up?
One man. He's a tiefling.
Okay. I'll approach. I'll introduce myself as, Cornhard. I mean, I'm not going to lie about him. I'll say that I have spoke with the sheriff and she has issued me pass to talk with Habe.
Give him the letter.
Yeah.
Looks it over and he says, please allow me to go speak to the master. He's like, I'll return. 15 minutes pass, and he comes up, opens the gate. Now, are you on your horse at this time?
No.
Okay. Because I got to ask that, because it's just something that you don't really usually see.
Yeah.
He welcomes you in. Let's see. Reception room. Gotta figure out where you're coming in at here. Walks up the steps, you enter a reception room. There's a desk. Doesn't look like anybody's used it in a long time. And the guy walks the door. There's a human there too at the desk, and he points to this door off to his right and has office on it.
I'll thank him and I'll go. Is it open or?
No, he just tells you he's expecting.
Okay. I'll
open it up.
I'll knock once and I'll open up.
So, sit there and there's a man there. He stands up, shakes his hand. He's like, I'm Aaron Hay. How can I help you?
Ornark Tornhard.
Sticks his hand out for a shake.
I shake it.
He takes his glasses off. He's got a towel, kind of wipes them. He's got sweat on his brow, kind of beads it off.
Okay. I'll say, was told that you house a couple people that were wrapped up in this blood fog.
Tiefling hands you the letter and puts his glasses on. Kind of, it's like, yes, Helen
and Gerald.
He's like, we've had Gerald for about a week now, and poor Helen's been here for about a month.
Okay. I'll say, I'll actually ask him how long this blood fog has been going on. I can't remember if she told me or not.
No, it's just something here in the last 2 months that's kind of fell on our poor community here. He's like, bad thing is everything I've done to cure sanity that I've learned from Corvosa, he's like, nothing seems to work. These people are dead set on believing what they see.
Corvosa. Okay. Mm-hmm.
And he's like, and I'm inclined to believe them. I don't think this is just natural insanity. There are people that have been missing from town. You can tell, though this man is strange and awkward, he's very well educated.
I'll tell him that whenever I spoke with the sheriff, she told me that they believe somebody's in the fog. What,
He says, that is all they talk about. The color red sets them off.
Are they in a place where I could attempt to speak with them?
Yes, he tells you the only thing that may be an issue, or I do have other patients in the area, and they do tend to get excited when people are in the area, even myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I cannot promise you it'll be a pleasant experience.
That's fine.
It may bring you out of focus. He's like, I will apologize for that ahead of time. Have you ever seen Reanimator?
Yeah.
This dude looks like Jeffrey Combs.
Okay.
That's who I imagine this guy looking like. He looks
All right.
like Jeffrey Combs.
All right.
But he tells you, it's like, but if you would like to speak with him, he's like, I will be more than happy to take you there.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Thank you. I appreciate it.
He takes you up a set of stairs. And as you come up them, he opens up, and you're in a large room, and there are 5 cells. These cells, basically think of prison cells, bars, cross
yeah.
bars.
Just kind of small,
you look around, as soon as you do, there is a man who literally wears a bandage across his eyes, an old skinny frail man. And there is a very heavy set man. And they just, when you come in, they just start acting crazy. They shriek. It's incoherent gibberish as soon as you guys walk in. And they are loud.
2 men?
Yes, these 2 men.
I'll ask if one of them are Gerald.
He tells you, no, Gerald is on the end. And when you turn a corner, he says, right here is Helen.
Okay.
Okay, we have your miniature made by Hero Forge. They do pretty awesome jobs. It's just expensive. Kyle learned a good lesson with buying the cheap one.
Yeah, you buy the cheap one, it's cheap.
Okay, so you have red garb on here.
Yeah.
Do you wear red?
No. This is from whenever I was a sorcerer back in the old, at Pathfinder. Now I'm kind of wearing kind of a shiny plate.
Okay, well, the question is, do you have red on you?
I would assume, honestly.
Okay, now he's going to tell you, they will lose it when they, just, like, there might be a gem in your crown, definitely on your hilt, your sword.
Yeah, my sword.
He's
just
warning you, when they see this, they will lose it. Roll me a wisdom save. Because these 2 guys, Gerald and Blind Sedge, are being extremely loud.
Oh, shit. 13.
You cannot focus.
Okay.
He can kind of tell that he can't focus, and he's like, I did warn you.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, now it will get worse once they see this red on you. He's not asking you to remove it. Because being a man of psychology and science, he knows that you have to get a reaction out of people to study them.
Yeah.
From the room you just came from, he scoots out 2 comfortable chairs, and he sits in the middle of the room with one, and he motions the one that you need to sit in front of one of these cages you can with it.
I should
say cells, they're not cages.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they are cages, but whatever. Let's see, the one I went to first was you said.
Okay, basically, you've got 3 cells.
Mm-hmm.
You come in this door, 2 cells, and then there's another door. 3 cells. You can tell one cell looks like it's been recently occupied, but there's no one in it.
Okay. The one, whoever I come to first would have been Helen, right?
Yeah, right. If you turn the corner, she's right there.
I'll sit down in front of Helen.
She sees the red on you, what little there is. Her eye, Think about when we talk aliens and just eyes water water because we're terrified of aliens.
Oh my god.
It's not so much terrified, I would say, you know, it's just that odd curiosity, right? But anyways, you could just see she's just quivering in her eyes, just she doesn't blink, yep. But they just stream tears. And then she starts mumbling and she's like, those eyes. She's like, those eyes. And she's like reaching and she does this. And she acts like something's reaching for her and she keeps doing this. And she just keeps talking about the eyes. And she's just darting around like something's trying to grab her. She gets up off the bench and she's in a straitjacket and she's just screaming and running and bumping it through the wall under the bars. Blind, Sedge, and Wald, they're shrieking. And their babbling grows louder at this. You see, Wall, he's a big, fat, rotund guy. And he just slams himself up in the cage. And, like, his fat is kind of hanging out. Poops and he's just, just screaming. And he's got a hold of the bars. Yeah, he's, like, in a cell right beside her.
I'll attempt to start any kind of dialogue with her. If she'll speak to me, I'll ask who's in there.
So she's like, you can't see them, and like she's just darting around. They're everywhere, and like she's just steadily crying. But it's not a she's screaming this entire time.
Yeah.
Roll me a perception with disadvantage.
Okay.
Well, probably not, 20.
Probably not going to be that one. So that would have been 26. 16.
Okay. Through the shrieking, you can hear someone else, which you would assume would be Gerald, and you can just hear him screaming, shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up. I mean, it's just constantly over and over. Shut up, but you can't see him because he's in the cell behind you. You just hear him, shut up, shut up, shut up. I mean, it is extremely hard to focus.
Yeah.
You look back at Aaron Habe, and he's just sitting there. Like, nothing's bothering. He's got a pad. He's just writing down his. He's kind
of... The reactions that I'm getting off these people. I'll turn around to Gerald. And I'll ask if he sees the eyes, too.
You walk up. And he's not... You don't see him moving in his cage. You walk by, you see a blind Sedge, and he's just screaming. And he's not in a straitjacket, kind of like Walt. And he's just sitting on his bed, just screaming, shaking his head. You walk up. You can tell that he's not moving around until he sees you. And then that shut up, he just stops. And it's just the same thing. He locks onto the red. His eyes grow wide.
Yeah.
The tears start to stream. And you see him. And he just starts doing the same thing, jerking back and forth like he's trying not to let somebody touch him.
Whenever I walk away from Helen, does her mannerisms change after she doesn't see the room? Okay. Well, what I'll do is I'll take my sword, I'll set it off to the side, I'll take my sleeves, and I'll kind of start rolling them up.
Well, whatever you've got, you're going to start doing that. Aaron asks you, he's like, if you could, please put those back in the room where the stairs where you just come out of. He's like, any side of that is going to trigger them off.
Sure.
And you can see he's writing this down as you're saying it.
Okay, I'll do that.
So you go in there. He's got like a coat rack and stuff because things tend to set people off. And by the time you come in, she and him have calmed down.
Okay.
But Wald and Sledge, they've lost a lot of their wind, but they're still just... screaming, but it's calmed down a lot because they've wore themselves out.
Okay. I'll go back to Helen. She's the first one that I would come across, and I'll sit back down, and I'll ask her to describe what's in the fog. What's in the blood fog?
She's sitting there, she's sniffling, and she says, bones everywhere. And she's just sniffling and crying. She's like, skulls, hands, the dead, they're everywhere. She's like, I can feel the blood on me. She's like, and their eyes glowing green.
I'll turn to Gerald. I guess Gerald can hear me talking to her.
Well, yeah. Well, he can hear, but you still got these guys yelling.
Yeah. I'll ask Gerald the same question. Does he give me the same answer, basically?
Basically, yeah.
I'll ask, hey, where were they in town, or were they found in the farmland, or where were they?
Aaron Hay tells you Gerald actually managed to find his way around town. They found her running around the farmland. She's like, the odd thing was, they were covered in blood. He's like, the few that have passed away from just the shock and the trauma were both found
covered in blood. They were talking about death that walked within the fog. Did anything weird happen with the ones that did pass?
He's like, I'm not understanding.
There was no hiccups with burying them. There was nothing. They were talking about dead walking. Did these dead walk or anything like that? Mm-hmm. The people that passed?
No. No, I mean, they're married out in the boneyard. They're in Sandpoint. He's like, we keep no bodies here.
Mm-hmm.
If you're asking to inspect them. He's like, those that died, whatever brought here, not a mortician. He's like, but they've all been buried in Sandpoint.
Do you know about the... Or are you familiar with the recent... bodies coming up missing at Sandpoint?
No, that's news to me. I don't make it out of the sanitarium much. One of my gentlemen that aids me usually goes in and gets us supplies and whatnot. Because I really don't get out much with these two being here.
Yeah.
He's like, you know, it is important to me to cure these people. They have families.
Yeah.
You know, and Sandpoint is their home.
Okay. I was just gonna try to see if
there was a connection.
There was a connection between the people that died within the fog and these bodies that were dug up or got up or went missing. I'll just say that. I'll ask his helper, which I didn't know if it was a tiefling or the human he was talking about that goes to get supplies.
Mm-hmm.
I'll ask whoever he was talking about if they knew if it was the people that had died or the missing people in the graveyard.
So you're going to like step out and go downstairs and ask them, or are you just asking
Harry? Oh, I thought, I'm sorry.
So you're upstairs now.
I thought they were with us.
No, it's just you.
No, I won't step away just yet. I will ask them before I leave. That's something I will ask. Were these people just farmhands, or what were they?
Tells you Gerald was Helen. What she was doing out there is what baffles me the most, because she's a prostitute from the Pixie's Kitten.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure what she would have been doing out there. That's very odd to think that someone who literally lives in the bed they get paid in would be miles outside of town.
Yeah.
My guess is maybe some farmer wanted to take her out there.
Yeah.
The interesting about her was she was reported missing 5 days before we found her.
So she's been out there a while.
Yeah.
I'll ask.
So we're not sure exactly when this happened to her within that 5 days. It could have been the first day, could have been the last.
I'll ask, I'll say, have you had someone recently passed.
What do you mean?
I'll point over to the cell that was occupied not too long ago.
So, we do cure some people here at the sanitarium.
I'm glad to. That's excellent. That's awesome.
He's like, as you can see, I'm sure the mayor told you that, you know, I don't keep a lot of people here. I do good work.
Mm-hmm. Well, I will thank him for his time.
And he says, oh, no, thank you. It's nice to have a visitor every now and then. I don't get many out here.
I'll go collect my things.
He'll walk with you downstairs.
That's when I'll ask his two people.
If there was
a correlation.
The tiefling's the one that always goes outside town. He says, no. It's like, I just go in, get the supplies, and I come back.
Okay. I'm going to head back into town. I'm going to grab my stuff.
While you're talking to him, roll me a perception.
20?
Both the tiefling and the human both wear a necklace.
Oh. And Habe doesn't.
Habe doesn't.
That I seen.
Habe's white button up shirt. I mean, he looks like a scientist.
Yeah.
No. And he'll escort you out the door, back to the gate.
Habe does?
No, the thief one does.
Oh man, I was about to say I was going to ask him about the necklace, but I'm not because I don't want to get an entire. I got some questions I want to ask in town before I do anything with that necklace.
All right. So, they escort you out, locks the gate behind you. You going back to Sandpoint?
I'm going to go back to Sandpoint. I'm going to talk to the sheriff.
Okay.
About, I want to ask the sheriff if there's a correlation between the people that died and the people that are missing. I want to ask the sheriff who that he recently cured.
Okay.
That was able to be returned to town. I want to make sure that's real.
Okay, yeah. So, you go, you find Sheriff Bill or Hemlock. The first thing you're asking is, the people that died from blood fog, are they the ones that risen? He said, no. It's always been older bodies that's been out there for a long time.
You had said that. I wasn't sure.
Just made sure.
Yeah. And the second thing I'll talk about is he said we do cure people here also. I'm going to ask who was recently
brought there
and returned.
Not everybody from Sandpoint's there.
Okay.
He says some people do bring Magdemar. Magmar do come up. Aaron Habe does really good work.
Okay.
So not everybody's always cured. I cannot tell you who he even has in there, besides Helen and Gerald. Because I said he does get. I would not be surprised if there are people from Riddleport in there.
Okay.
If you put them in there yourself, I'm just saying.
I haven't sent anybody here.
So. But no. Any other questions you have for the sheriff?
No. I kind of want to go out to the farmland and poke around.
When?
Today. I mean, I would like to go out there.
Well, they said it was at night.
I know. I kind of want to go out there and start heading out there. No. I'm sorry. I want to go to the kitten?
Pixie's kitten?
The Pixie's kitten. And I want to ask about Helen, who, if they know if she was hired to go out there, or if it was a job that brought her out there.
Okay. So you're going to go to the Pixie's kitten. 43. Roll me some percentiles.
79.
Hey, roll me a d6.
6.
You see almost a whole crew of Sarah's ship here while you're here. Two very well-built men stand outside this door. One of them is a half-orc. Neither one of them stops you from entering. They just ask that you leave your weapons at the door.
Is there like a closet or something?
Oh, they've got a room that's a room that they're going to put them in.
Sure.
So, anything you guys? So what you carry? Anything besides your sword?
No. Yeah, I have a short sword, my falchion, and a light crossbow.
Okay. Yeah. Anything that you could use as a weapon, they're going to ask you to.
I'll unload.
You walk in and. This place isn't as good as the Abyssal Angel, but there are very attractive women here. You do see almost the entire crew. Yeah, so it's a kind of crew thing. Yeah. Form, Sarah, and shit. There is a attractive woman who introduced herself as Kay Tesserani. She is the owner of Pixie's Kitten. And she calls you by your title and name. She was like, "We were hoping that you would grace us with your presence, Lord Tornhorn."
Yeah, Dark Judge.
Yeah. She's like, "What do you prefer?" And she's got a group of young boys and a group of young girls.
At least it's open, you know?
Oh, yeah.
No judgment there.
No, there is no judgment in this place.
I'll say, actually, I would like to have a conversation with you.
Over?
Gold coin.
She says, we do like our gold coin here in the Pixie's Kitten. She says, please, come to my office. And she takes you to a very lavish office, which you would... actually probably look like it's a prostitution's room. It's lavish pillows. Everything's really lavish here. And she makes sure when she sits that she gives you a peek. When she closes her legs, her cleavage. I mean, she sits up so her tits really show. And she's like, so,
I actually have a few questions about one of your girls that does work for you or used to work for you.
All right.
Helen? Well, I forgot what. It was like Sade. Yeah.
She's like, she kind of hangs her head down and she says, go on. Like, you can tell already, she does not want to talk about this.
I'll tell her that I actually spoke with Helen just maybe an hour ago.
She won't look up at you, and she's like, I'm taking it. She was not in good health. You can tell that she kind of cares.
Yeah. I will tell her that they're working with her, trying to bring her back to the state she was in before the blood fog.
Where you're talking, and she's already shaking her head. She's like, they never come back.
They don't.
She's like, no. She's like, they usually all die. And she looked down and she's kind of wiping tears from her eyes.
Was it a customer that brought her out where she was found?
She was just gone one day. It's almost like she left in the middle of the night.
Okay.
She was she's like, anything you need to know, she's like, you can ask Sheriff Hemlock. He already knows everything.
Okay.
You tell right now, she really doesn't want to talk. Right. There's one thing she did not want to talk. Like, she come in here, you walked in, she had high hopes, and you just shot him all the way down.
Well, I'll tell her, I'll say, I'm sorry, I'm very sorry for bringing this up. Since the sheriff knows about this, he's probably a little less attached than you are to the subject. I'll go bother him, and I'll leave you. I apologize again for bringing this up. I'll give her a few gold pieces. I don't want to take up any more of her time.
She doesn't want your gold. She slides it back. She doesn't want it.
Okay.
I mean, she can't even look you in the face when she does it.
I will tell her I'm trying to figure out what's going on to try to stop what's going on.
She kind of gives a little sarcastic giggle. She's like, no one's ever going to figure it out.
Yeah, that may be true. But I'm going to try. So, I want to leave. I didn't mean to fuck her up like that. I guess I'm going to go talk to the sheriff.
Shut the door behind you.
Yeah.
And you hear something glass break in there.
I can fix it for her. I have men.
Walk in there. Boop, boop. So you're going back to the sheriff.
Yeah, I'll go talk to the...
He's like, so I'll talk to the mayor.
Yeah.
I think it's good that you want to help the town of Sandpoint. He's like, but you realize, you know, some of the stuff that you may be looking into is going to upset some folks.
Found that out.
And we like to keep it quiet around here.
Yeah, I found that out.
He's like, so, before you go poking around anywhere, I would ask that you come to me first.
I can handle that.
He's like, I understand that you may be the wall in Riddleport. And he grabs his hilt of his sword. He's like, but I'm the wall here.
That's understandable. I would ask the same if anybody was in my town.
So, where is it you went to Pixie?
I did.
Probably upset some people there.
I did. Kay. I upset Kay.
It's the worst one to upset.
Sounded like it as I was leaving.
Boys outside, I can't promise you, they might not, they may come visit you.
I'll talk them down.
He says, many men have tried.
I'll ask him the same about, if he knew anything of why she was out there.
No clue. No one knows. Kay takes care of her, property very well. They're well treated, well taken care of. She's like, it is rare to see any of them even leave the Pixie.
Yeah.
He's like, I've been asked the usual clientele for Helen. That being said, it's harder to ask people that come in and out of port.
Right.
He's like, but usual ships that come in with deliveries, I have taken into custody and questioned people that we do know that frequent there often. It's like, no clue why the young girl went out there. It's a bit tragic.
Yeah. I try to fake some emotion. Well, no, not like that. I guess I try to fake some empathy. Like, yeah, I guess it's very tragic.
You can tell he has no empathy towards it.
Well, I might head out to the farmlands and just poke around a little bit.
Tells you, I've got trolls out of the farmlands. It's a lot of land to cover. You go missing. Can't promise you we'll find you.
That's fine.
He says, mayor told you about them giants out there too.
Yeah, some hill giants are poking around.
Occasional goblin tribe will steal crops.
Yeah.
He says, to be honest with you, being out in farmland is no different from being out in the wilds around here. He's like, but farmers tend not to bother the goblins, they steal a couple crops. As long as the goblins aren't coming around burning down a barn.
Yeah.
It's like, there's giants out there. We don't have giants around here.
So that's very different.
It's very different. It's kind of worrying some of the folk. He's like, will they come here? No.
How long have the giants been around? A couple months?
About a month. It's kind of odd.
Yeah.
He's like, he tells you off to the... east of here, we've got the Brine Stump Marsh. We've got trolls there. Trolls will keep to themselves as long as you don't cross over the Lost Coast Road. As long as you don't cross their territory. He's like, it's almost kind of an unwritten understanding between folk on the road and then that Brine Stump Marsh. He's like, but I've seen trolls. Them are giants.
Yeah.
Just by reports. He's like, so you run into them, it'd be best if you ran.
I'll keep that in mind. Appreciate the word of warning.
He's like, so when you heading out? Because that way, if I know you don't return, I know to come looking.
I have an obligation here in town for dinner, and I'm leaving after that.
Okay, so
I'm gonna go get the boy, treat him to a good dinner.
Oh, so you're gonna go see him?
Yes.
Beforehand? Is anything gonna role play out?
Not really. I just want to take him to the White Deer. Show him a really good time.
Yeah. All right. So you're gonna go out to the farmlands at night.
Mm-hmm. I kind of want to catch.
The boy's very, very excited to see you. Talk to you about family. Seems to be his thing. And,
I noticed that. And I will talk that shit up. Like, I will make him feel...
Are you going to bring it up to him that you might take him away?
I'll ease into it. I won't just come out and be like, hey, I'm going to take you with me. I'm just going to talk to him about the importance of being with family, remind him that we are family, tell him how about ships and how, you know, I've been to where, shit, what was his name? Grandel? Was that his name?
Yeah
Grandel. Where I've been to where Grandel's from. I have access to go there, things like that.
He asked you if you can take him to Grandel.
We could go there.
All right. So you're planting that seed.
I am.
All right. So, and then you're going to wait a couple hours so it gets dark, or are you going to go before it's dark?
I'll head that way before it's dark. I'll drop him off. So, you know, I don't want to keep him out too late. And then basically I'm going to jump on the horse. I'm going to head that way.